So, hello everyone. My name is Georgi Danovski, and I'm a PhD student from the Bulgarian Institute of Molecular Biology, Bulgarian Academy of Sciences. And also, I'm the responsible person for the image analysis in the Bulgarian neurobioimaging node. So, today I will present to you our software, CellTool. This is a software for bioimage analysis and also for mathematical modeling. The main goal that we wanted to achieve by creating this software was to combine in a single package the bioimage analysis, the post-processing of the required of the acquired data after the image analysis, and also the mathematical modeling of this data for our research. And because of that, we want to create a nice and user-friendly interface that allows the user fast and reproducible to do a fast and reproducible research. So, I decided to make this presentation as a live demonstration of the software. Like this, it will be easier for me to present you all the functionalities of the software. So because of that, I will start by starting the software, and directly I will show you everything inside the software. I hope that this will be perfect for you. So if you have any question, you can stop me at any time and ask if something is not clear or you have another questions. Well, the best part is that the experiments that we are doing in our research, they are including a lot of RAPA, a lot of micropoint irradiation, which are similar to the required, to your requirement. So our software has a multi-user password-protected interface that is under the control of administrator. This means that only the administrator can create new accounts. The accounts are created locally on the machine. They are not sent to us. So the whole information for each profile is stored on the local machine. Every user can set up protocols, can set up his interface, and this information will be stored in these protocols. This is particularly useful when the software is installed on common machine in image facilities where many users will use the same computer. But if you are using the software on your own machine, you can simply log in as guest, and yeah. So this is the main user interface of our software. As you can see, it is a single window interface that is divided into panels. On the left, you can see File Explorer. This is a similar File Explorer to the one that you are usually using, that you are familiar with Windows and other operation system. From here, you can browse for your files. You can add directories, work directories from your computer by simply browsing to this directory, pressing OK, and the directory will be added to this file browser. From here, you can do a lot of stuff. You can copy, cut, paste files. You can delete files, rename files, make directories, and all that you are familiar with. But there are a lot of options that you can use also, like the one that you can sort the items that are inside. You can use the virtual box to extract only the images from given directory. For example, here I'm extracting all the files that can be opened in the program by simply clicking the upper folder here. So this is useful. You can also search for items. For example, I can choose to search in all directories. I can choose to search only in the virtual box, or I can choose to search in a folder. If I choose to search in a folder, when I press, for example, cell 11 and press find, yeah, there is no cell 1 here, but yeah, like this. And I press the search button, it will find all cells with that name. If I want to open a new file in the program, you can do it by right click and open, you can double click it, or you can simply drag and drop it here. in the middle, now you can see the main panel where the image will be displayed. This is two-channel image that is time-lapse microscopy of single cell with micropoint irradiation. You can see where is the place that the ultraviolet laser irradiated the cell. And you can see both channels, the red one, which is MCHERRY labeled PCNA, and this is RPR tagged with GFP, EGFP. And also you can see the merged, the composite image in the same time. So, just a second. Yeah. So on the right, you can see the properties panel and also this box here. From here, you can change the lookup table of the image. If you want, you can change the color of this channel by pressing right click and selecting the color. You can even specify a specific color if you wish. Also, by pressing the left button on some channel, you can disable it and remove it. You can zoom in, zoom out, you can move and look at the image. And also you can change the brightness from the properties windows. This is a histogram of the image, and by dragging this, you can change this line, you can change the maximum or the minimum brightness. Also, you can apply the settings to both channels. Like this, you will see for both of the channels what is happening. And you can use the autobands, which will resize the lookup table in order to see all the pixels in the image. You can use the right click button on the histogram, and like this, you can specify a specific number for minimum and maximum of the brightness and contrast. So this is the brightness and contrast windows. Below him, you can see the metadata. Here we have a simplified view of the metadata where you can see the basic metadata of the image, but you can also look at these settings here. And from here, you can look for all the settings. I can show you for your images. Here. So if I open, for example, this image, this is the image that your colleague sent me. From here, and pressing button view, you can see the metadata of the image. Also, for this one is a bit bigger. Here you can see what is the microscope that you use and what are the settings that you have applied, which is useful if after time you want to check is everything was okay with the protocol. Also from here, you can change if something is incorrectly read. We are using bioformats, but problem always can occur. You can change the Z, T, which means that sometimes some software store incorrectly the time-lapse experiment as Z stack or something like this. You can change this from here. And also, if your experiment has time steps in it. So, for example, if you have 10 frames that are captured in an interval of 5 seconds after you have, for example, 10 frames that are captured in half an hour, you can specify this from here. So I can edit this to be 10 times 5 seconds, and I can add another that will be, for example, 100 repeats per 10 seconds, per 5 seconds. This is information that will be required later during the analysis. So I will close now these images and I will continue this one. Below the metadata, you can see the ROI manager. The shape of the ROI can be changed from the menu here, from this line here. You can choose between rectangular, oval, polygonal, freehand, and magic wand. this is the first shape. You can add the ROI to the ROI manager by pressing Ctrl plus T or by pressing this plus button here. This is the other ROI. You are familiar with this tool from other software also, and this tool here also. So these are the usually used ROIs for the measurements. So I will continue now with the image analysis. Here you have a box with three boxes in it. The first one is called raw images. This is the first column here. The second one is the processed image. So here is the raw image and you can always look at it. And here will be the processed one. By pressing with mouse button here, somewhere in the processed image, different options will appear in the process, in the properties window, in the properties panel. Here you can see the histogram again. Also, you have access to the filters, segmentation methods, spot detector, tracking, and ROI manager again. Now we'll go through the whole options here to show you how to use them. So first I will start with the filters. We have different convolution methods in our program. They are divided into three categories. The first one is smoothing. Here we have 3 to 3 box size box blur, 5 to 5 pixels box blur, also Gaussian blur and median filter. These are the most common used filter for smoothing the images. Here we have also sharpen algorithms. These algorithms are usually used if you want to sharpen the images, which is not particularly useful for image analysis, but yeah, we also added them. Here we have edge detectors and gradient detectors, which can be used for gradient detection. I can show, for example, Sobel operator. This will show where are the edges in the images. You can reset a white filter by pressing the button reset. So for this image, now I will move to this one, with this channel, and I will smooth by using Gaussian blur. This technique is useful if you have noisy images with low signal to noise ratio in order to make a better for better segmentation. So you first apply a filter that will smooth the image, and after you can move to the segmentation method. We have two global methods for thresholding, which are also thresholding and k-means method. I will use this image also thresholding method. So you can choose how many thresholds you want to be automatically calculated for this image. If I choose only one threshold, press the zoom histogram, this tick here means that it will calculate the threshold based on the histograms, the zoom histogram of the whole image stack. If this is not checked, it will use only the current frame histogram. If I press this button and I press one threshold, it will take only this group. If I press two, it will segment bigger. And for example, if I move to here, you can see that you can segment the image by using global thresholding. So now you can see that the FOSI has two colors in it. We can change these colors to whatever we want from here by pressing right button on these boxes. This shows the color of each group of pixels. If we choose the same color, this region will become the same for the the software will think that this region is only one, not two, which is useful if you want to track some signal that is evolving to, for example, we call it a hole. So I will show you now how to track spots. Usually the cells are rapidly moving, and you can, if you want to measure, for example, what is the mean intensity.
Georgi?
Yes, of course.
So when you change the color of a class in the thresholder, it's like you apply a new label. So
yes, exactly.
Yes, if they have the same color, it has the same label.
Yes. It is useful for the next algorithm that I will show you, the tracking algorithm, because sometimes you want to track in the same time objects that are with higher intensity than the background and objects that are with lower intensity than the background in the cell nuclei. This is the cell nuclei that I'm showing you now. So if you want to just measure what is happening here in this region, if I apply a static region of interest, the cell will move and I will not be able to measure what is happening there. Because of that, we developed a tracking type of one. Yeah, by pressing this here, I can enable a chart that allows me to check what is happening in given region simultaneously with the image analysis. Now I'm showing here the mean intensity of the pixels inside this circle for whole time slices. Okay, if to be able to measure what is happening in this spot here, I need to enable the tracking ROI type. So this is a static ROI type, this is a tracking ROI type. So when I move to tracking ROI type and press circle, I can track the spot during the whole image stack. And you can see immediately the results from the measurement in the software. If you want to look only at the images, you can just press double mouse click somewhere in the field and you will extend the field of view. By a double click again, you can move to the previous look. So, okay, I have ROI that is okay for me, and I can copy it by moving to the ROI manager, right click and copy, or just by pressing Ctrl A to select all ROIs, Ctrl C to copy them, and so Ctrl A, Ctrl C, and move to the other channel, I press Ctrl V, which will paste the ROI. And like this, because this both of these proteins are involved in DNA repair, they are co-localizing at the point where we hit with the ultraviolet laser. And now you can see in the same time, two proteins measured for seconds. So, these proteins here, they are very with very nice signal to noise ratio, which is usually not like this in our experiments. We are using backtagging, and because of that, we have a low expression of the proteins because they are under the control of their own regulatory regions, which means that the intensity in this is 16-bit images, which means that the maximum intensity of the image is around 64,000. And the intensity of our image, as you can see, and this is a good image, is around 500, which is very low. And because of that, we usually use PCNA as a control for our experiments, and here as a green protein we tag a different protein of interest, and we are using the region of interest that we obtain from the PCNA, which is easy to segment, and we copy it to the other protein, and like this we can measure even very very low expressed proteins. So this is if we are using circle ROI, but for micropoint experiments, if we move at the frame where the irradiation happens, which for our experiments is this frame, you can see here that the intensity in the region where the laser hits, it is happening something similar to frappa. It's not visible like a frappa, but you can see if you measure here that you have a drop down exactly at the moment when we frap. Because of that, we developed something that we called a stack ROI. By pressing this button here, I enable the stack row type in combination with oval row and rectangle and tracking. Now again, I will press with mouse here on the segmented image, the region that I want to track. And you can see now that I have region of interest that has a central circle and peripheral circle divided in four quadrants. This allows me to measure the intensity around the spot, and like this to use it as a control for the normalization. So now we have the blue line here, which is the main ROI, and the red one here, which is the control ROI. If I select the chart, different options will appear here. From here, I can change what to be displayed on the X axis. I can change to T-slice, T-second, Z-slice, T-in minutes, and T-in hours. I will use T-in seconds. For Y axis, I can choose between area, mean, minimum, maximum, and total value. By pressing this here, you can move to a specific function that everyone can apply here by using these rules here in order to make some calculation even on the step of the, when we are doing the image analysis. Okay, so I will write a formula here and I will explain what I'm doing. First, I want to take the mean of every frame and I want to subtract from it the mean of the peripheral circle. Like this, I will subtract the background in the nucleus by the from the signal that I want to measure. So if you look at this here, it is saying that the first index is the ROI index. This means that this is the first ROI, the second ROI, the third ROI, and it's zero based. And if you leave it without anything, this means that it will be applied for every ROI. The second one is ROI layer. This means that if we have a layered ROI, if you press zero here, it will be applied for the central circle. If you press one here, it will be applied for the first layer and so on. The third one is used if you want to take the value of a specific frame. Now put this in. And I will subtract the fifth frame, which is the frame immediately after the irradiation. I'll put five here and five here. And after, I will multiply by the area of this. So I will add this and I will call it micropoint function. And if everything is okay, when I press okay, I write something wrong in the formula. Yeah, it's this one. Okay, let's check again. Okay, I'll take the formula from. Okay, this one too. Okay. Now I have applied a function that is subtracting the peripheral ROI from the central ROI and also is applying normalization to zero. When this is done, I can export the result by pressing the save button This will save the image. And when the image is saved, I can press the auto export button. And I will look at the image, what happened there. Okay, I have this result here. If I look at this in other program like Excel, you can see that here you have the results measured for the from the experiment on a given time. I'll delete this and I'll show you the result. Okay. Also, you can do something different. You can use the results extractor tab. By pressing this button here, you can create a results extractor tab in which you can add work directory. Which will display you all the things that are measured there. Because we don't want the red, we can simply click here to remove the red channel, or we can use filters by adding in the filters menu and say, I don't want by using this mark and say, I don't want to see red. And now you will see here the results. From every repeat, here is the average data. I'll show how the experiments look if you have many repeats. So you have many repeats of the same experiments, but from different cells. And you can, if you have some outlier, you can simply click here and check this one. For example, I think it's outlier. You can just remove the tick from here. And immediately the new average curve will appear. So here we have all the repeats of the experiments. Here we have the average curve. The information can be normalized to 1, from 0 to 1. We can do a double normalization of the results. And also we can apply subsets to the x-axis, which is timing now. Here you can see the fitting panel. So here we have the numerical data extracted from the images, and here we can apply our mathematical models. I will remove all the calculated fits. Control A. Remove all of them and I'll start from the beginning. I'm selecting this type of fitting, S4 fit. So these whole models, they are well explained in our MoCell paper, which I can show here. It's called Protein Dynamics in Complement DNA Damage Lesions. In this paper, we examine more than 70 proteins that are participating in the process of DNA repair. And we model all of them by using our software. Here you can see all the proteins that we, I will leave it to. It will take a little time because it's a lot of data that will be displayed. All the proteins that we have measured from here, you can check the kinetic of each protein. And also you can check what is the model that is used for this protein. This model can be applied from here, can be used from you for your experiments if you have protein that has similar behavior. For this protein, I will use S4 fit, which is a formula that looks like this here. Now I will use our algorithm for automatic parameter estimation, which will start to variate each of these parameters here in order to find a perfect fitting for this curve, for this raw data curve. So first I need to put some random values in order the algorithm to start, for example, from here. When I press the button solve, the algorithm starts to calculate and it finds the curve. If I'm satisfied by this, I can store here in the fields panel the result, or I can change some of the variables and I can start again the solving algorithm. You can define the minimal and the maximal value in which every parameter will be variated. And after, something that is very useful if you want to have a standard deviation for each of these variables, you can use the solve repeats button, which will start an algorithm that will solve the equation with starting parameters, the one that you have calculated for the average curve, and it will calculate these values for each of these repeats. And when the algorithm is completed, you can check the results from here. You can check how the fit is looking for every cell that you have. You can do it with even more than these cells that I am showing here. It's a 13. I have 13 cells here. And when this is stored, I can export the results in a way that the results can be viewed in other program. I'll export it to the desktop. And I can open it in Excel. This is the result. In the first block, we have the results from the micro point with mean and standard deviation. After, we have the normalized results to one with mean and standard deviation. And after, for each fit that we have obtained with our solver, we have this block here where we have the X values, the Y row values, and also the Y row values, and also the fit values. We can check. Also, we have the variables. So variables exported with the root mean square deviation, coefficient of correlation, R square, and also the formula that we have used. And this like this for every experiment. So this is useful for micropoint experiments, but we can use the results extractor also for FRAP measurements. I will open now a FRAP experiment and I will show how you can use our software for fast analysis of FRAP experiment. You can see here, again, I think it's RPA tagged with EGFP. And here is the frame where we have the FRAPA. So for our software, the software that we use on our microscope, it's exporting the region of interest that is used for the FRAPA in the metadata. So you can use directly the autofind, which will, but here I will not use the multi-layered rows. I will use only the circle row. When I press autofind, it will show me where the software of the microscope is thinking that is hitting the cell. But you can see that it's a bit, it's 2 pixels away from the real place where it hits. I can move manually the ROI and I can look at the results. Okay, this is the region which is FRAPT. Okay, but if I want to do some glitch correction, I will need to have also a region which is the background in the mean value of the cell and also the mean value of the background noise. Because of that, I will apply again smoothing to the processed image and I will use also thresholding with only one threshold to process the image. Okay, now the image is segmented with one-dimensional thresholding and you can see the segmentation. If you're not satisfied by this segmentation, you can move the threshold that is calculated, and like this, you can make better segmentation. For my purpose, I want to have the whole cell perfectly, I want to capture the shape of the cell. I will move to static row, and I will select the magic one too. And by pressing somewhere in the cell, I directly have a row that is capturing the cell. By pressing Ctrl T, I am adding the row to the row manager, and also I have the results from the cell. So here is the cell. Okay, now I will use, for example, a rectangular row to measure what is happening outside the cell. When we calculate this, we can save again by using the save buttons and auto export the data. Now I will show you how this results is looking in the results extractor tab. Here I have already calculated results from Frappa. Here you can see by using the filter, I can filter only the row one, which is the Frappa region, or I can filter only row two, which is the background in the cell, or row three, which is the background outside the cell. Okay, here we have the whole results visualized. We want to do some glitch correction. By pressing right-click somewhere in the data tab in the results extractor, you have access to this acquisition glitch correction button. By pressing it, you can select the glitch frame, which is 5 for me now, the pre-glitch frame that will be used for the calculations, and the post-glitch frame. Pressing the button process will normalize the data, and we will finish with something like this. Okay, this is good. We have the results, we have them in the repeats chart, and also we have the average curve in the results panel. Now we want to model the results. I will delete all previously calculated data. Now, the Frappa experiments, the models are coded in this 5 model here. The first one can be used for a rectangular array in combination with single exponent. This means that our solver will solve the reaction diffusion equation in the terms that now we have only reaction or only diffusion, and both of these will be displayed on the chart here. So the magenta curve will show the diffusion equation by using the Ellenberg's equation, and the green one will fit the data only to single exponent as a reaction. The second one is rectangular row, but double exponents show reaction. Here is again the rectangular row. This means that the diffusion will be calculated by using the Ellenberg's equation. If we are using oval rows, we can use different equation, the equation that is calculated by some passes in combination with single exponent or double exponent. So these 4 types, I can see that there is some question. Thank you. Okay, so if we want to fit the data directly to the full reaction diffusion equation, we can use Frappa binding plus diffusion model. This will fit directly to reaction and diffusion. This can be used if we suspect that our protein is binding to the chromatin, for example, and at the same time it is diffusing because it has a sole diffusion. So in our case, I will use oval row with double exponent. So this is the model. Now I need to put some parameters in these boxes here. The first one is W, which is the weight of the region where we wrapped in micrometers, which for us now is 1.65, I think, micrometers. Yes, yeah, somewhere there. The bleach occurs at frame 5. And now this is the only parameter that I need to put in the solver. I press the button solve and it calculates the curve. If I'm satisfied, I can store the information. Can give it a specific name as I want. And I will press solve repeats, which will calculate the result for all the repeats. Okay, again, I can save the result in a CellTool data file. For example, I will put it on the desktop. So this will store all the information that you can see in this tab in a single file. So you can take it, put it in an email, and send to some collaborators. And when they load the file in the program, they will see the same thing that we are seeing now. And I will export also. And I will look how the results are looking in Excel. So again, we have the results for each experiment separately, also the mean value and standard deviation. In the comments here, you can see the gap ratio value and the bleaching depth value, which are useful for each cell. And also you have the information from the fitting here. So what we have here? Here are all the variables that are used for the calculation of the fits. This fit here is the first one. It's called fit frap equation. This means that this is the double exponent. It is this equation here. So the data is fitted to double exponent. This means that this is a reaction that has two components. So this is the first curve. It uses only these values here for the calculation. For the second equation, it is diffusion, only diffusion, and it uses only these parameters here. I'll change the color. So the first curve here is the result if we are suspecting that there is only a reaction in the equation and the diffusion is very fast. This here is a chart that we will use if we suspect that the protein is not binding to anything in the cell nuclei, but is diffusing very slow. So if our protein is the second case, we use these two parameters here. And we use this equation. In other case, we're using this equation with all these parameters here. Also, we have calculated the half-time of moving back the protein.
Recovery,
yeah. Sorry. Okay, we have also this information calculated for every repeat. And by this, we can calculate the standard deviation for each parameter. So this is the result from FRAPA measurements. I will show you one more situation in which we have experiments that look like this. We can divide cells and we want to measure what is happening with the intensity of the protein inside these cells. Okay, you can see that they are rapidly moving, they are changing their shape, they are even dividing. What we will do now? I will enable the processing, I will select the processed image and I will use the Gaussian blur 5x5. After, I will perform image segmentation by using single threshold, which you segment the nuclei. Okay, but you can see that, for example, here, the cells are mistakenly taken as one. This is because this is only a global thresholding method. What we can do? We can convert the image to binary. Convert the image to binary from here until I select the foreground, which is the yellow one. Okay, when I convert the image to binary, the convolution disappears, but the binary operations appeared. I can apply erosion, which will erode one pixel layer from each foreground object. Delayed, which will add one foreground pixel to the edge of the foreground. Or I can use open or close. This is a combination. Open is erosion and dilation. Close is dilation after erosion. I can use fill holes to fill some holes like here, or I can use watershed, which will be useful for our case now. If I select, I can select the tolerance for the watershed, and I can choose the distance map algorithm that will be used for the calculation. Euclidean is perfect. In combination with fill holes, okay, we applied it already, but yeah, I will leave the tick mark. When the algorithm is ready, you can see that these blobs are now divided. Let's check what's happening with the other cells. Okay, everything is perfect. Now you can see, because this algorithm is relying on the shape of the object. If we have a perfect blobs like this one, it will be not divided by the algorithm. But here, during the division, you can see that this cell is mistakenly divided to two. This is not a problem. I will show you how to overcome this situation. So now we will not use these algorithms here. We will move directly to this one. This is the tracking parameters. We can define the minimum size in pixels and the maximum size in pixels of the object, and also the moving speed of the centroid of the object that will be used for the calculation. When I move to tracking type ROI and I select magic wand, I can perform a tracking of the object over time. For example, this here, I will press mouse. You can see already we have ROI. Control T, I'm adding it, and I can check what is happening with the intensity, with the total intensity in the cell. And here you can see that the cell is perfectly taken. Okay, but what is happening here? With this cell, I will try to track it also. So I'm selecting, I'm moving back on the video, and I'm selecting, I want to check this cell. And what is happening? I'm moving back. And you can see that everything is tracked fine. So here, because I put a filter of minimum size of 1000 pixels, and this object here is with lower size, this means that when the algorithms reach this frame here, it will use the last time, the region of interest calculated for the last object that satisfies these parameters, because it's starting to calculate the region of interest from where we point with the mouse, and it's moving backward and forward from that point, and it's finding the closest centroid to the previous object. And when it reaches the problematic region, because it didn't find close enough object that is satisfying these parameters, it is using the already stored parameter until it finds the satisfying object. So you can overcome this problem here by playing with these parameters. Like this, you can track over time cells even after division. We can track every single cell in the image, and we can export the result also. And yeah, here we have. So, okay, another trick. If we're using polygons like this, we are not sure that if we just move like this, we'll see if somewhere something went wrong and some cell are taken by mistake, are taking two cells, for example, in the same time, in the same row. So I can move to area, the X, Y, and the Y axis to area, and I can see where a problem can probably occur. So here, for example. But here, everything for this row is okay because just the cell is dividing. But we will have a spike if somewhere some cells are taken together by mistake. So this is useful to check before exporting. And after you can move to min or whatever function you want to see the result. You can specify the color of objects of the chart here by pressing right click on the box with the color and change the color to whatever you want. And the color will change, you can see here. You can also enable and disable some of this region of interest. And if you disable them, they will not be exported after auto export. Okay, now about the row manager, you have some options here. You can export the row set and you can import it in other images or you can store it somewhere. You can load the row set from here. From here, you can measure. It is similar to auto export, but with measure, it will prompt you to place the name of the experiment. But with auto export, it will take the name of the image and it will put the extension, the color channel that is used. Okay. Something that can be useful because now I'm showing you only the only manual analysis of the experiments. You can use this feature here, it's a protocol, auto processing protocols. I will open this image and I will show you this is a time stack, again, micropoint irradiation, but we have here also a Z stack. From the edit menu, you can convert the image from 8-bit to 16-bit. You can do some projection, substacks, export processed image, and also you can modify the stack. You can merge channels, you can extract channels, delete channels. You can do the same with Z planes and testwise. Okay, now I will perform a maximum intensity projection. You can use different algorithms. You can do maximum intensity projection, minimum intensity projection, or average intensity projection by pressing this button here. I use maximum intensity projection on the Z stack. By pressing process, you can see that the image is converted to the projection. Okay, now I will perform some image analysis. I already explained to you, so I will do it fast just to show you how you can use the protocol feature. On the segmentation, I'll use two thresholds. Okay. Now track some objects. Okay, and I will apply micro pointer. I didn't measure on this one. Okay, this is the first image, and I can use the feature of storing the protocol. Here I can select a name, for example, micropoint, RPH. I can select, is it necessary the software to prompt every time when you open new image, a pop-up window where it will ask, do you want to apply automatically the protocol from the previous one? I can remove it or leave it. I will remove it for now. And you can choose what to be stored in the protocol. I will put the filters. This is the convolution and binary operation that are used on this image. Segmentation, these are this segmentation here. Tracking, these options here. or chart axis, the options that we have applied to the chart with the results. Also, we can apply this stick here, which will move the time intervals that we stored. Okay, I will save. Just to be clear, this interval that are shown here. 5 times 5 seconds, 360 per, yeah, this interval will be automatically transferred to the next images. Okay, I will open now this image, which is the same protein like here. I will do again the projection. And I can press this button here, which will automatically apply the protocol. And now you can see the result. So it is transferring directly the thresholds. So this means that sometimes the segmentation may be not perfect. You can simply move here and press this button, and it will make a bit better segmentation. And this is useful because usually you have many images that are similar one-to-one. And by using the protocol feature, you can open all the images, you can apply automatically the protocol and simply select the feature that you want to measure. Okay, I will move now to your images to show how to handle, because one of it was very noisy, and I can show you another algorithm that we have. Let's check which one is it. Yeah, it's this one. Okay. You can change the color. Green, for example, this line. And I will apply, first I will use median filter in order to remove some hot pixels. If it's not exactly hot pixels, but yeah, to remove the some of the noise, and after I will apply Gaussian blur again. Next, I will use the auto thresholding by using only one threshold. Okay, this is the results. I can move to two thresholds. Okay. We can play with the thresholds if we want to measure the cell nucleus. We can play and do the same thing like with the dividing cells that I showed you before. And if we want to segment also these spots here, we need to use the spot detector. Now, this is a bit more confusing algorithm. I will explain what means all the, what all the, these track bars and boxes means. So the class that we will obtain by segmenting will be a cluster that is colored in red. We can change the color if we want, but I will leave it red now. All the pixels that are lower in intensity than the selected threshold here, I will use the maximum intensity, will be displayed. What means this? If we look at the histogram, the algorithm will start looking from here to find the first occurrence of this number of pixels here. I will put here, for example, 6,000. You can see where it goes. Okay, I can move down. I need to play a bit now until I'm satisfied. Okay, but you can see that it's not perfectly enough. You can change also the sensitivity. The sensitivity means that it will smooth the histogram in order to remove some occasion spikes that are appear somewhere. I will usually use 90% here. And we can move again. If we look, we have segmentation of some of the foci, but we can play again with this until we have all the foci segmented. Yeah, most of them are already segmented, but you can continue with this. When you have a satisfying enough segmentation, you can store it as protocol and apply to the next image and next image. And now you can select if you want to measure circle by using circle row, you can use the circle. You can use also a polygon to capture the exact shape of the, for example, this here. You can see that automatically we have polygonal row that is encircling the fossil. We can press here again, not like this. It's we can encircle all the regions that we want to look at. And after we can auto export the results to Excel and we can use the information. Another thing that we can do with CellTool is to use the plugin engine. For example, in that case, automatic algorithm that will find all the spots is very useful. So we will probably develop such an algorithm very soon because we need it also. And it will appear here in the plugins menu. Currently we have three different plugins that are available with the package directly after the installation. The first one is Calculization. Also we have Multicrop plugin and Plot Profile plugin. And also we are developing plugins for other groups if there is something specific that that is required. So the software is currently under development. So if you have some ideas or you have some requirements, you can also, you can just write us and we will consider to develop plugin or add some feature to the program. Now I will open two channel image to show you one of the plugins, how it's working. I will add one polygonal tracking CROI that is capturing the cell. Okay, and I will use the Calculization plugin. This is something that is very popular and can be very useful. So the thing that we have here, we have the two channel image. We can lock and the information that is in this table here is actually the results from the Calculization plugin. Here we have PCC value, R squared, MOC, MCC1 and MCC2. And we can select how big we want to be the image. We can select which frames we want to check the calculization. And here is the chart with the results from the calculization. We can also unlock the T position and we can compare different time slices one to one. We can use the ROI or we can use the whole image for the calculation of the these values. And also we can apply some thresholds in order to select only the pixel that we are interested in. And you can see the thresholds by looking at these blue lines here. The other plugin that we have is very useful if you have many cells. I'll close this image. These two. I will open this here. I will apply projection. So for easy analysis, we would like to create sub-images for every sub-image for every cell. For example, this one. And we want to store them fast on the hard drive. We can use the multi-crop plugin. We can specify where we want to put these images. We can select a class name and a suffix, for example, green. We can select, do we want the row that we have used to be copied to the data image? And we can enable tracking. If we are using not the rectangular, but magic wand polygon tracking row, we can use this multi-crop plugin to achieve something similar to segmentation, to registration of the images by enabling this too. but now process it with the rectangles. And if we refresh this, we will have this folder appearing here, open a new window, and here are the cropped images. We can select all of them, or we can drag and drop them here. When they are opened, we can see the images here. All of them cropped automatically. So the software is freely available for download from here, this site. And it's available for Windows, fully functional. For Linux, it is also fully functional. And for Mac, it's a beta version that we're currently working on to make it function working. You have also a tutorials where you can check all the things that I already explained you. Here they are explained in details. And also, if you go to the examples, you can look at the micropoint experiments, step by step, how to measure your micropoint irradiation data. And for FRAPA again, here is for FRAPA analysis. Everything step by step. And also the formulas that are used for the bleach correction and for the fitting explained. Also, if you are interested in developing some plugin for the program by yourself, you can use the instruction here and also in the tutorials how to create your own plugin. The source code for the CellTool is freely available at GitHub, and also there are some sample plugins that you can check from here. For example, I'll show you. Here is the multi-crop plugin, the DNF plugin also. And if you look at the code, you can check how to develop by yourself a plugin. Yes. This is the class that is very important to be in the program, in your program, in order for CellTool to recognize it. So, so this is our program. If you have any question, I will be happy to answer it.